Can you just start by giving us just a general overview, a synopsis of what Once Upon a Time in London is all about?
Sure. The film starts in 1936 and ends in 1954, and it's about the rise and fall of two real-life gangsters who very much, you know, came after the Sabinis and before the craze. And in a nutshell, it's their rise and fall.
You talk about the challenges of recreating such an iconic and violent point in London's history.
There were many challenges indeed. It's not a big budget film, and it's very ambitious for that big budget. In reality, it could have been made into a TV show with two or three series, I think. So one of the big challenges was really just condensing three decades into an hour and 50 minutes, to make a hopefully entertaining story. Well, as you know, Leo Gregory has been acting for a long time. He's a seasoned pro, done a lot of great stuff. It's a pleasure to work with, and Terry Stone again, likewise, has been doing it maybe a little less time, but still, he's done a lot of films, and both very dedicated to the cause. Both did a lot of research and try to get the essence of what the guys were about, and whilst maintaining the violence, but the characterization, and at times they have to be charming, and other times they have to be fairly nasty. So that's an actor's life for you, really.
I'm curious what you think it is about these characters, this world, that continues to capture our imagination so much.
Well, it's a good question, and actually it's a question which maybe nowadays is less easy to answer, because whilst there is of course much crime in the world, a lot of it has gone online. So there's a visceral element to this crime which doesn't exist as much as it used to, I think. And I guess, it was always a rags to riches stories, and there is something in the public imagination which loves to see people go from nothing to something, irrespective of if they break the law or not. So I think, it seems to be part of our British culture, to be honest, to be fascinated by these stories.
So I play Billy Hill, and this whole era is kind of 30s, 40s, 50s. So it kind of bridges from the 20s and the Peaky Blinders era to the late 50s and then the 60s, which was the craze reign. So Billy was more than a bridge in terms of chronological aspect. He handed the baton over to the craze, and he kind of... What people know of the craze is the celebrity gangster and that. It was kind of Billy that... He used to advise them on that a little bit in the early days, but Billy very wisely also saw something in the twins of himself many years ago, and he knew to maybe exit stage left at that point.
Yes, I mean, fundamentally, what do you think it is about the concept of gangsterism that fascinates us so much, that captures our imagination in a way that nothing else quite seems to?
I think it's one of our great British traits is the gangster film and the genre. I think, as a Londoner, those figures were to us what Robin Hood was to Nottingham, to the establishment and the authorities, they were bad people and they did some really, really terrible, terrible things. But at the same time, they looked after their community. They were a sort of police force in a sense. I'm not sure if all the moped muggings and stabbings would have been going on in that day and age. Let's put it that way.
Can you talk about working with this amazing cast as well? Because, I mean, it's throughout the film, wonderful lineup of talent, particularly Terry as well alongside you.
Yeah, there was great cast, great director in Simon Rumley, DP in Milton Cam. They work together a lot. They're a very good pair. The cast were great. I mean, what Simon did very well with this film was he wanted to make the two female leads, or Billy's female, he wanted to make them very rounded. Lots of times, they're the trolley bird or the, downtrodden. But the two women in this are very strong and very good actors as well. I was very blessed to work with Kate and Holly as well. So the rest of the cast, there's a few familiar faces in there, shall we see. There's Jeff Bell.
Hey,
it's Terry Stone. Yeah, look. Is that Nick Nevin? Yeah, so everyone other than Terry was wonderful.
So how my character Rita fits in is she actually comes into the story when it's all kind of already kicking off. There's already this rivalry between the two leads, Billy and Jack. And I think Rita is just, you know, an Irish woman who has like those, such integrity, and she's trying to bring goodness to the whole thing. And I think she's in a world that she's just not used to, this violence and this kind of awfulness. So I think she's the moral compass of the film, I think. Yeah. I think gangsters, no matter what era, is fascinating. Whatever country you're in, you could, you know, whether it's, you know, Britain or Ireland or anywhere. But these guys are the ones that trained up the craze. These are the ones that got the craze going. And, you know, whether it's now, like today in 2019, or it's back in the 40s, it's just fascinating, you know, like that these people that kind of have no value of life and just do these crazy things. And obviously there's so much human story to it, and I think that's not lost in this film. Like, yes, it is gory, and yes, it is kind of violent, but there is human story in there, so yeah.
It maybe surprise people how much of what we see on screen is actually based on real life, real events. Can you talk about your journey in terms of researching that period and your character?
Yeah. For me, so when I originally got the script, I started online, got a couple of books about Jack, because obviously Rita's kind of in every single one of Jack's kind of, you know, biographies and stories about him. And yeah, there's a lot of information online of the court cases that they were involved in, a lot of tabloid articles about them. So for me, research, even though I didn't meet anybody who actually knew them or family members, there was a lot for me to delve into, a lot of books and stuff. So it was a couple of months of research, which was, I loved it, because I felt like I had to educate myself and then drop it when I went in and just did what felt right at the time. But I went in as prepared as I could. So I hope I did her justice, yeah.
My character is a character called Bear's Breath. I play the right-hand man to Leo, who's playing Billy Hill, and Terry Stone playing Jack Spot. There's some great characters in this. There's some great actors in this. The character that I get to play is a tough guy henchman, and hopefully I play it well. I've had to live the life of a tough guy, so hopefully on screen I can portray it well. It's all about believability.
I'm curious, why do you think, you talk about tough guys, why do you think this period particularly of gangsterism in this country captures our imagination so much? Why do we revisit it on screen as often as we seem to?
Because this era was more physical. You know, there was more straighteners as such, punch-ups, more hand-to-hand combat. All right, it might have been razor blades, batons, iron bars. But the modern day on the world, it's a lot of gun battles, and anybody can carry a gun. You've got 16-year-old youths carrying guns. It doesn't make them a tough guy. I'm not saying that this era they were tough guys, but this era I think they were a lot tougher than the underworld figures today, physical-wise, like, you know. And I think it's more exciting to watch, for me anyway. I like to see a good punch-up on screen rather than a good gun battle, you know.
And obviously, I mean, we've seen so many great British gangster films. What do you think is unique about this one specifically?
Do you know something? Some of the storyline, well, if not all the storyline, there's so much truth in it. And that's what amazed me. You know, when I read the script, I thought, wow. You know, it's an amazing script. But then when I met actual people, I met a friend of the man that I actually play in the film. And I told him, and he said, Joe, them things really happened. And I thought, that's even more of a wow factor, you know, that these things really happened. And Simon did a great job in directing. Terry, Leo play great parts, and the rest of the cast are fantastic as well. So I hope, I really do, and I'm sure it will. I hope it looks amazing on screen. It looked amazing when we were filming it. I hope it looks every bit as amazing on screen.
I play a character called Moisha Blueball, who basically is Jack Spot's right-hand man in the film. So basically everywhere he goes, I basically watch out for him, I look after his money, that's basically it. I basically play his right-hand man.
Obviously the gangster genre has given us so many classic films. I'm curious what you think is unique about this, what people are going to see from this they perhaps haven't from other films in the genre.
I think this film's a little bit different because, you know, this is all about armed robberies, blags, you know, robbing, you know, banks, jewellery heists, stuff that you could get away with doing it in the old days, mainly because there weren't much CCTV footage, cameras like there is now. Like, you can't just go rob a bank now like in the old days. So I think it's going to bring a different side to gangster films that you haven't really seen. So watch out for this one.
Can you just tell us very quickly what it was like working with the rest of the amazing cast on this one?
You said it, amazing cast, working with Leo Gregory, Terry Stone, you know, Roland Manoukian again was just amazing. It was so much fun, a lot of banter, camaraderie on set. But apart from that, you know, when it comes down to working and being on the film and set and actually, like, saying, when the director said action, it was just amazing and everyone was spot on and serious about their role. And hopefully he portrays it in the film tonight. So, yeah, we'll see.
I was contacted quite short notice for this part, and it's a role. It's a real, true role of a character. It's not too dissimilar from the role I had in the Lockstock. It's basically the background of a kind of protector and a minder. The only difference was in this role, I took a bit of a beating. So, but I didn't mind. I went along with it, you know.
Why do you think the gangster genre is one that continues to capture our imagination so much? What is it about this world and these characters that holds our fascination?
Well, I think that era of gangster was kind of being, you know, it's a different era of gangster. Gangsters nowadays don't have the same kind of aura about them. They don't have the same appeal. I think, it's, you know, gangsters in that era are more clean-cut gangsters, ordinary decent criminals they were then. It wasn't the drug scene, it was more of a hard man scene, and therefore it's more acceptable to people, and it's romanticised a bit. And because it's so long ago, people have kind of forgotten about it and not really affected by it, so it's easier to appreciate the old-time gangsters, the old Al Capone era, the Cray twins, and of course the characters that were in the Once Upon a Time in London. Well, the fact is, you know, my character, as I say, it wasn't an easy one for me to do. I've done similar in the past. I did speak to a friend of mine who was a criminal lawyer in London, and I told him about the script, and he informed me. He said, "Steve," he said, "that's a true story. That really happened." He said, "That script is almost fact." He said, because he took it as a study in law school previous to him, you know, being called to the bar. So when I realised, God, this really happened, I hope we nail it and get it right. And seemingly we did, and the reaction and the word out there is all positive and plus, and it's been a really good performance from everybody in the roles of what did happen in that era.
So I played Belgian Johnny. I'm not quite sure why they made him a Belge, but they did. I own the brothel that all the gangsters from the Hills and the Adams family, who are the warring factions within the turf here, frequent, and I look after all their girls, don't I? So I should do that in a French accent since he was Belgian. But that's my part, Belgian Johnny.
Curious, why do you think not only the gangster life, but particularly this point in our history fascinates us so much? Why, of all of the criminal sort of underworlds, is that point in our history the one that we keep coming back to and exploring on screen so much?
Celebrities and gangsters have always mingled pretty well together. It's exotic, dangerous, fly-by-night, particularly for gangsters. And maybe celebs have some innate sense that they want to be gangstery. I don't know. It's dangerous. And the two shall always twain together, I'm sure.
Talking about being together, you're working with a fantastic cast on this one. Can you talk a little bit about that experience for you, what it was like, the atmosphere on set, and some of the wonderful people you're sharing time with?
It was a great time on set. I had some great scenes with Leo Gregory. Simon Rumley, the director, was fantastic. Terry Stone, who put the whole thing together, what a mensch. It was a really, you know, well-run set. It ran like clockwork. I love a set that goes like that, that's like a military operation. There was no wasted time. Very enjoyable time. And it was my first job bringing me back from LA. So I'm 25 years away, and I, fingers crossed, guys, this one could be the one that brings me home.
Of all of the figures of that world and that point of our history, why do you think the Cray twins are so iconic? What is it that captures people's imagination so much about these brothers?
It's just a general power of two brothers, you know. They're sportsmen at first, the respect they have for their family and the respect they get from the neighborhood, to show that from nothing you can rise. But obviously they've done a few things in the wrong way when they had opportunity that as athletes to still do the same thing. But I mean, sometimes temptation and ego gets to people's heads and they go down the wrong road, you know. So, but like my brother said, we're happy to betray them. We hope to show a new side as well to them and bring out the youth and depict that era of when they was growing up, you know. So.
It's an honour and a pleasure, and to be honest with you, we want more. We want more. It's not enough. We're hoping because the young Cray twins have never been portrayed before. So it's nice to have that honour on being the first on the screen of the younger Cray twins.
Sonny the Yank, I said I've read the sort of two lines I got in the movie. It's a lot for me. I said, I don't think it sounds very American. He said, no, he's not. I said, oh, right, okay, fine. So his name is Bernard Shack, is his real name. And obviously Polish, Jewish immigrants who came across, Jack. And I think Sonny was probably his old friend, you know, and obviously Moisha, Josh comes in, and there's the three of us. So kind of, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, that's for me, it was sort of, you're looking, I'm thinking, okay. And I don't want to tell you too much, but he's kind of like, he's Jack's old friend, I think, really. And he's sort of I think you'll see as it goes through the movie, it sort of becomes that, you know, Jack, you know, he's king of the underworld, you know. So it's sort of and I think Sonny's sort of, maybe sort of he's had enough of it, in a way, you know, without saying too much. But, you know, you watch a gangster film, you sit home and watch some of the stuff. You can watch some of the comedy gangster films or this, you know. This to me, is a much stronger movie. There's not lots and lots of laughs in this to me. It's a real strong film. Saying what it is, it's telling a story of... It's actually telling a story that's never been told before. So for me, you know, massively inspired by that, to be involved in something that has never been done before. You know, there's been lots of films about the Krays, you know, lots and lots, and with lots of different actors playing it, and been great, you know, great and great stories. But I think people love the thing, you know, sort of, I don't know, you know, my first film was Snatch, so you could go back and look at that. You could look at Layer Cake with Matthew Vaughan, you know, J.J. Connolly wrote it. You know, for me, when I haven't seen Snatch in years, but it's kind of that you look and you think, it's funny. It's sort of it's gangster, but it's funny, and I could only imagine, you know, in gangsters in real life, sort of how funny that might be. In fact, you know, I know the laws have changed in California. You know, I go out there quite a lot, and my friend's daughter runs a marijuana shop in Vegas, and they had a state of emergency in Vegas because they ran out of marijuana. So I kind of think, well, what are the guys who used to sell the marijuana doing now? What's their job? What are those gangsters getting up to? So it's kind of, I don't know, I think gangster movies, I know it's not horror films, you know, you either love them or you hate them. And it's sort of, I think a lot of people, look at Game of Thrones, you know, it's sort of a, you can't do that. How have they done that? You're not allowed to do that. That can't be allowed. You know? So it's kind of things like that. And if you want to go onto the knife crime thing, which I know I've been asked about previously. I know in this film there is that going on, and I'm a type 1 diabetic and I inject 4 times a day and I hate needles, and I wish people would sort of realise about life and about how precious it is, you know. So as Idris Elba says, you know, don't stab your future.
Hello, I'm Laura Carter. It's really interesting, isn't it? It's like the Cray twins. Everybody wants to know about the Cray twins and kind of like the violence and the history of the whole gang world back in the 1940s. It's interesting, isn't it? Everyone's intrigued by it.
Everyone is. I'm curious, when you're not here enjoying this film tonight, is there anything else you've got coming up yourself at the moment that we should be excited about?
No, actually, I've just become a new mum, so I took some time out. This is my first part back in the film industry. So, yeah, really exciting. But there's lots of things coming up. So, yeah, nothing in particular, but lots in the pipeline.
Just very quickly tell us about where you fit into the film for people who haven't seen it then.
Yep, I play the part of Daisy. Daisy is, let's just say, very glamorous, very naughty. Yeah, I play a very, quite a small part actually, but it's cute.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you got involved in this film and what you think fans can expect from it overall?
So I got involved, Terry asked me to come down, get involved in a film for him. So I'm only in it for a little bit, so nothing major, but it was just great to be part of it. Terry's a good friend of mine. We're doing a couple of things like documentaries and stuff based on football. So this was just a little stepping stone into me, do a bit of acting, have a, you know, see what it was about, get the experience. And you know, it's a fantastic production. The film looks great. And you know, some really good actors in it, so I can't wait to watch it.
People will be excited to hear that there's documentaries on the way. Can you tell us what that's generally about? I mean, obviously you said football. Is it anything specific?
Yeah, so me and Terry are going to be talking about doing a documentary based on mental health with footballers, ex-pros, and what they go through and kind of the whole stigma around things like that. So we're going to be looking at doing something together on that. Really something I'm passionate about, going through it myself. And Terry obviously wants to get involved, and I think it could be fantastic. There's some, you know, really sort of people that are really interested in taking it on, so it's exciting times.
I guess just on that, obviously there's been a real discussion about how much of an iceberg issue that is, particularly at top level, in terms of it's not discussed, but it seems to be bubbling there under the surface. Can you talk about, for you, just how big an issue you think it is in the professional game and what you'd like to see change in terms of how we address that?
Yeah, so for me, it's been a stigma for so many years. So many people just didn't want to talk about it. The whole thing in football was, you know, man up, get on with it, don't show weaknesses, you know, but it's not just in football, in all walks of life, everyone, you know, men can struggle all over the world. And, you know, a friend of mine, Mike Talitis, you know, passed away, and you know, he's obviously depressed and going through some hard times, and he didn't seem to be able to get out of it. So it's something I'm really passionate about, because I've been through it myself. I've been depressed, I've been down. So you know, I think there needs a lot more to be done in the world in terms of dealing with mental health. And I think a lot more now people are getting involved in it and seeing that it is an issue. It's not something that, you know, men can talk about it, and, you know, it's not be afraid to talk about it. I'll talk about it a lot. I go on a lot of talk sport, go on radio. And I feel like if you can help one person a day, if it's just one person, it can make a big difference to someone's life. And, you know, I think that stigma is starting to go now, where people can understand that it doesn't matter how much money you're on, doesn't matter what you've done in life, you're successful, not successful, people do struggle, and it's something we can all talk about and help each other.
Alf White was a really fascinating character, because he was Darby Sabini's, who was the sort of, you know, I mean, a lot of people might know that from the Peaky Blinders. They touch on Darby Sabini in that, but, you know, I think he's a little bit too fictionalised about who he really was and what he was about. And Alf White was his sort of partner. And so they were the main guys in Clerkenwell and North London. And then all of a sudden you've got the young upstarts coming along, and as everything is secular in that world. You know, the new people, younger, hungrier guy comes and takes over. But they still kept control of it. And he was a fascinating, well-respected man, Alf White, yeah. So I was very honoured to play him, yeah. You've got the 30s, you're coming out of depression. You've got young guys really getting a lot of money for the first time. The streets were paved with gold for them if you had the nerve to go out and take it, and these guys did, you know. So I think it's a fascinating slice of London social history that's not been touched on before, and I think that that's where it's going to stand out, and it's going to be a cut above the others, yeah.
It's a fantastic British cast alongside you. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like working with the rest of them, and particularly, I mean, Leo's performance, because it's great work from him.
Well, Terry and I have worked together a few times now, I'm very pleased to say, and I think I think he's fabulous in this film. And Leo's an old mate. We worked together. He's my little Leo, because I've worked with him when he was a lot younger. And so when you're an old boy like me, you've been about a few years, you see him all coming along, you know. And Leo's a fabulous little actor, and he's a really good actor. And he brings a real good charm and elegance to the part as well, which Billy Hill had in abundance, yeah, evidently, yeah.
Start by telling us a little bit about what is so unique and fascinating about the period of London history that this film spans.
Well, it's never been done. So, you know, if you look at, you know, if you go right back to, you know, Peaky Blinders, after Peaky Blinders, there's, you know, the 30s, the 40s, the 50s. No one's ever done a period crime. Yeah, it was crime. That was probably the pinnacle of crime in this country in that era. No one's ever done it. So that was why we chose that thing, you know, to do it from there. The Krays are, you know, they're celebrity gangsters. They were famous, you know. These guys weren't necessarily famous, you know. But, you know, Jack Comer, he started off in the 30s. You know, he was a penniless immigrant Jew. And he had the piss taken out of him. He was an outcast. He got bullied. And then he started fighting back. And I think essentially what happened was he built up over the years a gang of like-minded people. They started doing a sort of Robin Hood thing where they looked after fellow Jews and Jewish businesses, and, you know, they obviously got paid for it. They didn't do it out of kindness of their heart. But, you know, that was then what spiralled them out into, you know, where he was the king of the underworld, you know, in England. And then, obviously, he sat on there for a few years, and then somebody else came along.
Can you talk a little bit about the look and feel of the film? Because obviously, I mean, recreating that point in our history, I'd imagine from a production point of view, quite a challenge.
No, it's very hard. I mean, you know, 30s and 40s, trying to make something look, you know, period, is a challenge. But we did it, and, yeah, really happy with it. Really happy with it.
You just talk about balancing, like you say, I mean, there's two very different sides of people of that era. There's the charm, the charisma, and then obviously the very intense violence. You talk about getting that balance right from a narrative point of view.
No, it's important, you know, that it's not just people getting beaten up and stabbed and shot, you know. So we had to ensure that there was a balance between the violence and the humour and then, you know, the emotion. It's an emotional ride, that movie, you know.
What's really interesting is that the female counterparts for both of our leads are kind of very well-rounded, a little bit more explored than they perhaps are in other films like this.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I mean, they are. They're strong female characters. I mean, that to be strong, you know, they were coming off the back of the Second World War where their husbands were fighting, you know, to stay alive. So, you know, you did get three really strong women to play those parts. So, you know, we've done a gangster film with strong women characters, so we're pleased about that.
Yeah, so I play Bobby Warren. He's right-hand man to Frankie Fraser. He's a little bit of a tough one, a little bit of a loose cannon. I was speaking to the crew before about this film. I did a film with one of the guys before, and they asked me to do this. So it's my third film which I've done, but I'm excited to see what my acting career holds.
Obviously, just in terms of this film, it's exploring a period of London history that is perhaps less familiar and also quite violent. Can you talk a little bit about what people are going to take away from this that perhaps won't from other gangster films, what they're going to see that's unique about this?
Yeah, I think, like you just said, not many people know about this story. They were around before the craze. You know, Jack Spotcomber and Billy Hill were around before the craze, and they passed it on, you know, the East End onto the craze. So it's just an insight of exactly what happened back in the 1930s to 50s, and it's a bit of a rough film. It's not for the faint-hearted, but it's a really well-written script, and like I said, Simon Rumley's done an amazing job with this, so I'm looking forward to everyone seeing it.
What do you think it is about the concept of gangster that fascinates us so much?
I think, to be honest, you know, it's just an interesting story, isn't it? I think it's, you know, the way people lived back in the 30s. I don't think you realise that it was like that back in the day in London. You know, it's crazy what people used to go up to. You know, everyone knows the craze story. And I think the Jack Spotcomber and Billy Hill story is just as good. So, it's an awesome film.
About awesome. It's a wonderful cast alongside you. Can you talk about what that was like, particularly because some of those guys are quite proper sort of East End men themselves, and obviously you're having to put on a bit more of a performance than they were, I guess.
Everyone's a natural. Obviously, you've met most of them. You know, they're naturals. They're proper London lads. And me being brought up in Cambridge is I've had to kind of put on my tough boots and try to act hard, so to speak. And yeah, they're all, you know, as you know, they're all amazing actors. They've got so much experience, and I learned a lot working with such a great cast.
Obviously, it's fantastic to see you on our screens. I'm curious, are there other projects you've got coming up that we should be excited about? And kind of what are your ambitions in terms of where you're going to go with the acting?
Yeah, so I've just finished a film with Miriam Margolis called Ethel, which released again this year. It's a short film which is going to be made into a feature. And I don't want to run before I can walk in the acting. But it's I'm having fun. And that's what it's all about, I suppose.
Curious, what do you get out of that form of creative expression, being an actor, that is perhaps different from your experience being on stage and performing for us in other ways?
Well, to be honest, I was acting. I was trying to do acting before the band actually, and I suppose it's kind of the same as well. You're still performing when you're on stage. You're acting like you're putting on a show for people, and it's kind of similar. Obviously, toning it down a little bit, but it's the same kind of concept as singing, and you know that's what I love doing. I love performing, and yeah, hopefully it continues.